on the Arts, a state agency, through its regional arts funding partnership, Pennsylvania Partners in the Arts, PPA. State government funding for the arts depends upon an annual appropriation by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and support from the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency. PPA is administered in this region by Berks Arts Council. Arts programming on BCTV is also supported by the Wells Fargo Foundation and by Berks Arts Council.
New Arts Alive features a guest artist who will share their work for a better understanding of today's art. Program moderator is James Carroll. During the live presentation, the home viewer has the opportunity to call and speak directly with the artist. New Arts Alive is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit arts service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. New Arts Alive is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions.
Hi, welcome to New Arts Alive. I'm your host for tonight. I'm Ron Schira, sitting in for James Carroll. And I have a guest, a special guest with me tonight, Sarah Frances Gershbach. And she is a conceptual performance artist. And she lives in the Reading area. And she's going to talk with us about her work. Hi, Sarah.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm great. How are you?
Okay. Okay.
Very good.
So you're a recent graduate of Moore College with a master's?
Yes. I have my Master of Fine Arts degree, which I graduated August 11th. So I'm fresh meat.
Fresh meat. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, grist for the mill, right?
Right.
The art world does kind of run you through its ringers, that's for sure. So,
it's a tough world, from what I've heard. Everybody's been telling me before I got out. It's tough. So,
it can be a killer. But, you know, it's gratifying as much as it is challenging and rewarding. So tell us about your work. What do you basically do?
I consider myself a performance-based artist. I work with sculpture, which I use as a performative object most of the time, and I also create video work, and I also use photography in my work, so mm-hmm. I use a variety of media. I don't pin myself down to one specific way of working, which is something that was reinforced within me during my time at Moore College of Art, and my breakthrough kind of came about when I went to Ireland. I had entered the program primarily as a printmaker, mm-hmm. Which I still really love, the physicality of that medium and all the things that it can do. But when I went to Ireland, something kind of happened, and I started to work directly with my body as a form of expression. And one day, an artist from one of the colleges in Ireland came through, Louise Walsh, and I was doing a self-portrait where I was working on doing a large size drawing of myself using flies. And she said, "Why are you trying to be a good little studio artist? Why don't you use the actual material? You know, get out of the idea of that you have to be in the studio drawing something. You can actually use yourself and use the materials to create a work of art." And that was kind of my moment where I realized that I could do anything, and mm-hmm. and that art can be anything, and it was a really exciting breakthrough for me.
That it brought in all of life, which included you know the environment and people and personal experience, and not just this separate object that you make and you you put into a gallery somewhere, and then people look at it, and then they, you know, there's like this removal of personal space there. Mm-hmm. When you're doing something like that, then you're making a product as an artist, but here your product is actually your experience.
Right. I had a professor at Moore that told us something as a class that really resonated with me. She said, when you forget that you're making art, when it just becomes a secondary nature or part of your life, then you're really getting somewhere. It's not the exact quote, but it really resonated with how I like to work and how I like to think about my work as an extension of how I see myself and how I am living my life. Mm-hmm. So I have some images of some of the work that I did in Ireland at that kind of breaking point. Should we go to the computer?
I can show some of that. Let's take a look. I just have a couple of things.
Let me do the slideshow here. And let me make sure that it's going to stay there. Great. So this piece is called Bucket of Truth, and this came at a time where I was really questioning what my work was about, because that was sort of part of the breakthrough, was also a questioning about what I'm going to do and what I want to explore with my work. And I was really feeling kind of really frantic because I was here in this international residency kind of situation. I only had 2 weeks left, and I had to figure out what exactly my work was about, and I had to do it quick. So I was joking with my studio mates. I said, oh my gosh, I'm just going to drown myself in a bucket of water, which I wasn't really going to do, but then I thought about it. I'm like, well, what if I did just plunge my head into a bucket full of ice-cold water? Because that's kind of how I feel right now. I feel like just shocked, like getting, you know, Gatorade dumped over your head. And I plunged my head into the water, and I would pull it out, and I would put it back in. And one of the things that I discovered in the bucket of truth, like I like to call it, was right as soon as I had to take my head out of the water, I could hear my heart beating. And I thought that was really interesting, because what I found in the bucket was my own heartbeat. Uh-huh. And that was sort of a catalyst for how I thought about my work then. I was thinking about man, woman, human, humanity, and my own sense of self, uh-huh, hearing my own heartbeat in my ears.
How long did you keep your head underwater then? Was it to the point where you were going to pass out?
No, it was just sort of like an exercise, because I never did performance before or a performative kind of action, and I mm-hmm. I wanted to get this information out of my body. I wanted to find out what it was like to do just a simple performance, like just putting your head in cold water, and I found something. So the next couple pieces that I did while I was still in Ireland were really exciting for me. One of my professors suggested that I go out and I argue with a glacial erratic. And a glacial erratic is a giant boulder that is carried from very far away by a glacier. And as the glacier melts, it drops this big boulder onto wherever it lands. And I felt sort of myself like a glacial erratic, because I was in Ireland and it was a culture shock, and I was there for a very long time. And I was just trying to work out these feelings of how I was alienated, but also kind of alienated from my own sense of purpose within my work. So the mm-hmm. argument that I had with this boulder alone on a beach really was able to draw out some internal content mm-hmm. that I didn't know was inside of me. Because when you argue with something that doesn't answer back, you're actually arguing with yourself. So that was kind of the second performative thing that I did when I was in Ireland, and that's the first strip of images that you see up top there. The second performative piece that I did was called Searching for My Ancestors, or Listening for My Ancestors, sorry. And this was along the rocky coast in Galway Bay, and I really felt like a strong connection to my grandparents when I was there. Mm-hmm. So I decided to dig a hole and bury my head in the sand for a couple different reasons. A, because the sand is very ancient in Ireland, and I said before I went to Ireland that I wanted to smell the dirt so I could smell what ancient smelled like, and also because since my grandparents had passed away, I kind of used it as a metaphor for their own burial, but I was trying to find them within this kind of ancient, maybe spiritual sense. So that's what this lower strip of images was from. And these are both still images from video that I shot when I was there on scene. And then I would take images from it that sort of summed up the performance and mm-hmm. create a piece from the images.
So this is actually a video piece that was recorded, and you've broken it down into stills.
Right. It's the video was recorded, and then the actual piece exists within these images. Mm. for now. We'll just get out of there and we can talk about some other things. Or well, I can keep going.
Well, it doesn't matter. We could keep going. That's all right.
Okay,
what else you got?
Well, when I got back from Ireland, I can pull this up. You want to talk about this piece with the show, or?
Sure, why not?
We could talk about this.
Oh, let's go there.
Okay. So, when I got back from Ireland, I started to think about my identity and started to look at myself, and I can't really escape the fact that I am a woman, and I really internalized those things into these next couple pieces that I'm going to talk about. This piece called Make Up Me was an investigation into all the different faces that I can have. The image is kind of small in here, but what it is a conglomeration of all the different kinds of makeup scenarios that I could come up with. And I would put them on this glass mirror, or this clear glass in front of my face. And instead of creating what would be considered a beautiful face, it kind of became like this kind of grotesque mask, which I thought was really interesting. So there's everything from like foundation to a mascara to lipstick to a face mask to powder, and it just created this sort of performance of different faces or different scenarios of the way that I could look, which talks a lot about my own sense of what's beautiful against maybe what society thinks is beautiful. So this second piece, which is also from a video, right now it's existing in images, but the piece is actually a video, which I'm not going to show here, but this is called Brainwash, and it has to do with the pain of maintaining, specifically if you're a female, you're considered to maintain femininity even throughout your most intimate moments, like hygiene, or even when you're alone, you're still maintaining this idea of femininity, which I was looking at specifically as a sort of masquerade. So in the video, I sort of self-baptized myself with this soap and then painfully let it run into my eyes and mouth as I try to scrub sort of the idea of my own femininity into my head. And it was a sort of durational piece where it was very painful and my eyes were watering, and at the end I just sort of look into the camera with a glazed look in my eye. Let's see. So this next piece also deals with the idea of the feminine as masquerade, and it deals with makeup and the purity of the idea of femininity. And what I did in this piece, it's called All Natural Makeup Remover, was I put a full face of makeup on, and I went out into the freshly fallen snow and imprinted my face into the snow, allowing it to remove my face and then create this imprint within the snow to create this image. Mm-hmm. And this piece you can actually find in this month's issue of Creative Quarterly Journal. It's issue 27 or 28, I believe it's 27. Which you can't get around here, but if you go online, you can view the journal and you can also order it. So I'm pretty excited about that because it got published.
What's the name of the journal so people can search it if they want?
The name of the journal is Creative Quarterly.
Creative Quarterly?
Mm-hmm.
Where's it based out of?
I believe it's based out of New York. I know that Barnes & Noble carries their journal, but mostly in Philadelphia. Not around this area.
You probably can Google it then.
Yeah.
But.
So this next image was in a show called Five Into One. It was five schools in one show around the area before I graduated. And these are some images from a piece called Sink Bath. And this piece was an interesting sort of investigation into my roles as a female and getting them sort of mixed up. And I've just finished writing my thesis, and one of the ideas in my thesis was about the Venus, and not necessarily the Venus in the goddess sense, but Venus as in this idea of the image of femininity. So I tried to set up these scenarios in my work where I played the Venus and maybe thought about, okay, well, if she would approach the dishes, like, how would she do it? What would she do differently?
I'm your Venus, I'm your fire.
Right. Yeah. So it just juxtaposes two different activities that are considered characteristically feminine, perhaps, that are combined into one. Kill two birds with one stone and make a really interesting and funny piece while you're doing it.
I can just see myself trying to do something like that. I would never fit.
Yeah.
So what is the idea is pretty much, you know, stay in the kitchen, do the cleaning, do the cooking, all that kind of stuff.
And then clean yourself also.
So you might as well put yourself in with the dishes, huh?
Yeah, and I didn't serve dinner on the dishes. I did put them in the dishwasher after this, I promise.
Oh, my.
So everybody jokes that knows about this piece. They're like, you didn't take a bath with the dishes, did you? I'm like, no. So this next piece and the piece that I just talked about, which was called Sink Bath, is also part of a larger series that I did called Doing the Dishes. And I approached the task of doing the dishes in a number of different ways. And this was along the same lines of Bucket of Truth, which we saw in the very beginning. Mm-hmm. So I filled the sink with dirty dishes. There's a chocolate-covered pretzel. There's onion peels. There's a container with a half-eaten piece of cheesecake, coffee, and suds, and I kind of plunged my head into it. I'm literally doing the dishes. I'm like philosophically doing the dishes or mentally doing the dishes and sticking my head into them and finding the essence of what this task is, what it means to me, what are my obligations to it, is it characteristically feminine? All of these questions are questions that were going through my head while I was working on this particular series. Mm-hmm.
So do you consider this work feminist, or how much of this work has to do with the feminist movement?
Well, I don't necessarily consider this work feminist. I use the word feminine a lot because that's the word that is associated with the fact that I'm a woman. And I consider it an investigation into myself and the authentic self, and can you really find him or her? And is it possible to, like, find that internal content that you didn't know was there, or discover the authentic self minus all the layers of conditioning and social influences and personal influences, environmental things that all sort of condition these layers over
psychological conditioning.
Right.
Yeah. Like
burying yourself down deep in there. And a lot of the things that I am dealing with in this work does have to do with being a woman. But I wouldn't consider it to be tying into the feminist movement. The feminist movement is in its third wave right now, which is something that I talk about a lot in my thesis. And the third wave of feminism is very accepting of a lot of things that the second wave of feminism in the 60s and 70s sort of weren't accepting of. And some of those things that are accepted into this idea now are actually sort of harmful to, I feel like we're taking some steps back in terms of that. So I really can't say that I'm speaking specifically from that movement.
Right. Well, there's not an us and them sort of ideology going on. Well, there's, you know, male and female have this sort of adversarial sort of approach to it. It's more of the idea, well, this is what it means to me to be female, to be male. That's sort of the,
yeah, and also this is what I'm questioning about my own femininity, because I'm raising a lot of questions here about how I see these things the right way. One of the questions that I raised in my thesis was about, or one of the things that I stated in my thesis was, can women really blame the patriarchy anymore? I don't think so. I think that maybe if they point the finger, there's three fingers pointing back at them. I think that today, more than ever, women are embracing this image of themselves that can be seen as harmful, especially within media. And the more I see women able to accept the images that are perpetuated of femininity on television and through media, I see it as kind of taking a step back, because it's promoting an image that might not necessarily be helpful for self-definition.
Right. They're actually on television, in the movies, and that they're selling sex, you know.
Right.
Which is actually what I don't think a lot of people really understand, and you know guys too. You know, I mean, it's all the same. They're putting these shows and these movies and these promotions on TV, wherever, internet, to sell something. You know, they're trying to make money out of it. So if they can get some sort of lurid type of fascination from the viewer, that means their product is getting out in front of the
right.
in front of the public.
And more, the woman is becoming this product.
Yeah.
But it's so hard to maintain this image that's being sort of sold to everybody outside of that sort of media outlet. So that when the woman actually kind of steps out of the TV and into real life, it's sort of looked at by society as kind of disarming, even though it's so prevalent within that accepted source. Mm-hmm. It sort of needs to stay there. As a society, we sort of seem to really love it, but once we're confronted by it, it's a little scary.
Yeah. Well, confronted with your true self, it there's an old Buddhist proverb that says that if you look deeply into yourself, and the deeper you look, the more you're going to see nothing. And it's very true. I think you don't really. I mean, we tend to put these, like you say, masks and shields and.
I feel like there's a lot of truth in that. I've never heard that before, but it's really powerful, because one of the reasons that I started working with these ideas of the authentic self was because, as I was looking at myself, I realized that what I considered to be my own self-definition was actually made up of a lot of outside things. And I was like, I need to explore this. It was sort of like one of those unanswerable questions that I needed to get at. So
let's move on to the next images here.
Okay, so this changes pace. And this stems from a project that I'm doing on Facebook called Choose My Underwear. These images were actually produced from that project, and these are in my thesis show, which is at Moore College of Art and Design in Philadelphia, till the end of September. And these images are of me holding underwear that other people have sent me through this project called Choose My Underwear. And what these images sort of embody are the idea of how underwear, which people say aren't really meant to be seen, but they clearly are, how these pieces of garment are able to dictate a sort of sense of personality. And I was playing with that idea of what was the intent of the person that chose this for me? What were they trying to say, maybe, or think about my own personality, and how can I reflect that through what the underwear is demanding? So I created these images specifically from that project. And these are all kinds of sort of ideas of the feminine image, or ideas of a woman, like the jogger and the natural woman and the crazy comic book girl and the I don't know what you would call that, the woman and coming to terms with her own, you know, getting older kind of thing. And
well, another part of this too is that most of the time you never see this underwear. I mean, this underwear is covered by other garments,
right?
And you don't really see it. So what you're looking at here is a personal sort of impression of, well, what kind of underwear am I going to wear today that's going to make me feel like this? It says something like that too. So it's kind of like a, you know, that internal privacy.
Right, and a lot of people put more time into what they're going to wear as their underwear. Into maybe what they wear over it. You know, maybe they have an impeccably you know, thought out underwear drawer with everything folded up, or maybe it's all a mess, or when you go shopping, as a woman, I've had this experience that when I go shopping for underwear in certain stores, you're confronted with a woman in a business suit who wants to take you around and help you find that perfect pair of underwear. And it's a really kind of funny and interesting aspect of femininity, because the thought put into something that most of the time you would think nobody ever really sees or knows about is kind of interesting.
Yeah, this is well, there's a whole psychology behind it.
Oh my God. Is she okay?
We just had a thing here.
Is she having a seizure?
I don't know.
So
I'm sorry. Okay. So,
okay.
Yeah. Okay. Let's. Okay. Let's go to the next image.
Okay.
All right.
So this is just part of the series with more images of the things that people sent me through the project.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll just go. So this is from a video that I was doing also that was dealing with hygiene, and also, well, I got the idea from We Never Have Fun in the Shower Anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And what I did here was I just kind of reenacted something from childhood where you're playing with the shampoo and you're creating different sort of shapes with your own hair.
Mm-hmm.
And this one is obviously the sort of hair of a man. And, let me think here. Let me get my train of thought.
She's okay. They just took her out, so she's okay. We just had some, might be the heat from the lights or something, but one of our camera persons here had passed out, and we had people just take her out, so she's okay. So just
okay.
To let you know that.
Right. So this was part of a larger video that I did. It's part of my thesis show where I put a whole bunch of different videos into one, and you're looking at the videos through the layer of hair, which hair is a characteristically feminine sort of signifier.
Mm-hmm.
And it also has a lot to do with like identity and self.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm also reminded of the story in the Bible of Samson and his hair.
Mm-hmm.
And how he was forbidden to cut his hair, and when it was cut, it was considered a breach of a contract with God.
Mm-hmm.
And just that idea, yeah, of how hair is so connected to, was connected to his identity and his sort of livelihood, and then how hair is also considered a big part of the feminine identity. Everybody freaked out when Miley Cyrus cut her hair, and the whole scandal with Gabrielle, the gymnast from the Olympics, and how people were, mm-hmm, criticizing her hair, and you know how scandalous that was, and that whole idea of being unkempt is connected to your hair.
Mm. A year ago, I shaved my head, and I got, it's like people panic around me, you know?
Yeah.
You know, my daughter, everybody was like, Dad, you look like an egghead, you know?
and the funny thing is, it grows back, I mean,
yeah,
for the most part.
It's hair.
So these images were from me just kind of playing with the idea of hair. And
you were sculpting.
And, yeah. Sculpting my feminine signifiers there. So this next piece is also in the thesis show, and it's called Feudal Piety. And this is also part of a video. Whoops, sorry, let me go back. This is a video that I did that deals specifically with how my grandparents shaped my identity.
Mm-hmm.
And even though that part of myself is now inaccessible, it's in the past. So I use these images as a way to talk about the future, but also the inaccessible past. As I read this recipe from my grandmother's Betty Crocker cookbook, the only sound that you can hear is the wind blowing. And I think I have a short video of this. You want me to?
Yeah, sure. Let's see.
Pull
it.
That up. Okay. Let me just find that quickly. Okay, here it is.
Now, another thing, too, is that you can find all of this work on the internet. I mean, you have a blog.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, here we go.
Okay, so here's the video, and you can't hear the sound, but the sound is just the sound of rushing wind, and I'm reading this recipe in slow motion, and I seem very sort of intent upon relaying this message, but it's sort of lost to the past. So it really has a lot to do with how important the traditions and the things that my grandparents taught me shaped my identity.
Mm-hmm.
But then it's also sort of about questioning how important these traditions are today in my own life, because sometimes they're really hard to maintain. Like the idea that if we don't bake 20 nut roll during Christmas time, does Christmas really come? And sometimes, you know, doing that kind of baking is almost impossible with everybody's busy life and getting together with family and that kind of thing.
Well, then again, too, you're saying stuff like one egg, you know, a pound of flour, that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. So we'll just keep going here, because I think we...
Okay. I have a couple more videos that I could show. This was...
There we go. Okay.
This is part of the Doing the Dishes series here. I called this piece Pumping Iron, where I'm actually lifting weights with a cast iron skillet, which is a very traditional piece of, I guess, cookery that you would use. But instead of using it in the traditional way, I'm using it to lift weights in my kitchen. So it's humor is incredibly important in my work. It's something that I use mm-hmm. sort of as a foil or a way to get my idea across.
It was kind of like a not a mockery, but kind of like a play on the male pumping iron. I mean, really, like you're saying, that's exactly what it is. But instead of going to the gym and you know, muscling through you know, 50 pounds of barbell,
mm-hmm.
you know, you're doing the same thing with an iron pot, which is just as heavy.
Yeah, and the funny thing about that skillet was when we got it, that skillet, I was barely able to lift it. And then after a couple of years of doing other things, in my other job and that kind of thing, I gained the strength to actually be able to do bicep curls with it, and I was pretty proud. But it is in my kitchen, and I'm using the skillet that I also use to cook pan-fried catfish, so that kind of goes along with my work being really tied to my personal life and using mm-hmm. my own kitchen as a backdrop or as a place where my art happens, where I investigate things is fun for me, and I couldn't see it any other way.
Yeah, but you're bringing everyday life into it too, because you're everybody's got to eat, you know,
right.
We all have to cook, you know, so it's a
right.
Let's do that. Okay, we are set for a break here. We're at the half hour point, so we'll.
I was just going to say, are you?
You're watching New Arts Alive on bctv.org. Be informed, be involved, be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For more information and an arts calendar, go to www.bctv.org.
Arts programming on BCTV is supported by the Pennsylvania Partners in the Arts, Berks Arts Council, and the Wells Fargo Foundation.
And we're back, and we are, just to let you know here, that we are broadcasting from Berks Community Television Studios in Reading, Pennsylvania. And thank you again for joining us on New Arts Alive. My guest is Sarah Frances Gerschbach, and we're going to continue. So let's see. The website, let's talk a bit about your blog, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Now, the blog is Sarah Frances 1.
01.
Sarah Frances 01.
Mm-hmm.
Dot blogspot.com.
Correct.
Okay. So it's a Google-based phenomena. I got one too.
Yes.
But they got it's a great little function, and anybody can go to it. All you have to do is just pull that website up and see literally everything that Sarah is doing. And it's very informative, very well put together, gotta say.
Thanks. My blog really serves an important function for my work because it's sort of, well, it's like a journal, but it's a journal that I can put out there for anyone who would want to read it. So I sift through a lot of ideas before I decide to just put it out there. But sometimes I'm a little less precious with things. Maybe I'll just make a list of things that I'm thinking about just to sort of see it written down, and then to see it, you know, up on the blog makes it real or important to me. I like to post images of things that I'm working through, not necessarily a finished piece, but just something that I might mm-hmm. be thinking about, or images that I might pull off the internet that I think are compelling, that I'm mm-hmm. thinking about while I'm working on things. So it's really valuable for me. I set it up as part of a class in school, and I never stopped using it. It was really became an important part of my practice, especially with the writing. Writing has become a really important part of my practice also, even more so today. Now that my thesis has been written, I want to continue writing about my work and about ideas that
I think
I find
that's a really good idea, to be honest, because a lot of artists don't really know how to talk about themselves. They depend too much on critics or other writers, journalists, to explain it for them. Mm-hmm. It's a good thing, you know, in my opinion, and some other, and I know my buddy James Carroll is up on this as well too, because he's always telling me to write about myself. But it's a good thing for you to try to put into words, you know, what you're really thinking, mm-hmm. you know, and you're doing that.
Yeah, and sometimes it's hard to find the language, and mm-hmm. working through that can help you sort of solidify an idea or kind of throw things out that you might pick up later. Mm-hmm. So the blog is important. Right?
So as far as the relationship to performance art, okay, mm-hmm. How do you feel your connection with performance art? I mean, there's a lot of art. Basically, you know, offshoot from the 60s and conceptual art, and how that comes together. This seems to be an extension of that, and it works that whole art aesthetic into a new dimension.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's true. I use myself to express things and to create work. Most of my performances or actions don't have an audience, and when they do, they're sort of an unsuspecting audience. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I will set up something or perform an action where I just want to create an image from mm-hmm. it, like with All Natural Makeup Remover.
Right.
I had the idea and I needed to perform that task in order to create an image. Mm-hmm. But I also like to have control over the image. So in some cases, if I do an action and I record it, make a video, sometimes I feel like the piece doesn't need to be the video. Sometimes it can be the images.
Yeah.
And that's my way of kind of picking out what I thought was important and being able to present that to the viewer.
Right.
Instead of maybe having the viewer decide for themselves what's important from the performance, I'm able to choose that for them.
Mm-hmm. I also was thinking of the you were in a supermarket, and you were choosing cereals and whatnot, and you had a ball gag in. You know,
yeah, that was
yeah.
one of the performances that I did that had sort of an unsuspecting audience, and I entered a grocery store clad in that ball gag, and I went through and I bought my things and I left, and I paid and I left, and that piece called You Are What You Eat had a lot to do with juxtaposing the idea of a traditional role or a characteristically feminine role or activity with maybe a more taboo sort of activity that you wouldn't want to talk about, or that was considered
right.
harmful or scandalous, and I combined the two, sort of like the combination in Sink Bath, and I went out there and did this performance for all of the people at Giant, and it was it was really scary, but I feel like it gave me information about some things, and I feel like the combination of those two created an interesting dialogue.
But does it tie
dialogue.
In with some of your other dialogues is, you know, the personal versus private. So, how do you know that whoever you meet inside of a grocery market doesn't have some sort of unusual agenda in their own minds? They could, they could be a very sort of salacious person in their private life.
Mm-hmm.
And the same thing, how do you know who you meet on the street? What's going on in their heads,
mm-hmm.
So there's this personal and this private and public image sort of thing, and that's, I think that ties in with your whole underwear and, the whole...
Right, or the fact that for some women, maybe shopping is completely foreign to them, but perhaps wearing a ball gag is not. Or maybe maybe the other way around, so that it sort of combined these two ideas of what's right, what's wrong.
Mm-hmm.
What really is right and wrong? What things are characteristically feminine or are we obligated to do? What kind of things are characteristically masculine? It's just kind of a questioning. I like to ask myself questions and then raise more questions through the work that I'm doing.
Questions, asking the right questions.
So, speaking of questions, the next question that I'm working on, and it's sort of one of those unanswerable questions, like the first thing, like what's my authentic self, is the question of what does it mean to be in a partnership, relationship, a long-term kind of thing, and how does that affect the self? And the question that I'm trying to answer at this time in my work is, how do I look through somebody else's eyes? And of course, you can never know that. It's something that you're told that you'll never know how you look through someone else's eyes, and they'll never know how you see them. It's just one of those things. I mean, you can ask, and they can give you words and things, and you get clues and cues from, how you interact with that person throughout the day or throughout your life together, but you'll never really know. And I find that really provocative and really compelling, so I'm sort of working very tentatively on ways that I can approach this question now through my new work. And the idea of looking at yourself as the other in a partnership and what that means. Because my past work, when I was doing my thesis, was taking the idea of myself as the other and then also somebody else's perception of me as the other and sort of combining those things into that work. So now I'm questioning what it means to be the other in like a lifelong partnership and how that sort of filters through, and can you ever really know how they see you, or can you ever
like
really find
in a marriage, or
can you ever really find their authentic idea of yourself? So
I think that's a common problem that's been going on in our country for quite a few years now.
I mean,
not
just
divorced people.
Yeah, I mean, and it doesn't really have to do with like dissent. It's just an interesting question that can maybe help get a better idea of how to make things work, or to get a better understanding of how to not, step on the toes of the other person that you're with, or to push the buttons or yank their chain. So one of the things that I came across when I was thinking about this idea was, of course, tied back to the idea of like my own sexuality and how when you're in a relationship in the beginning, the things that you worry about maybe aren't as important in the beginning as they might become later. And what I mean by that is, like, how you look and that kind of thing, it's really important in the beginning, and then it kind of tapers off. But then sort of in a longer relationship, you start to think about your own sexuality or the way that you validate yourself and how you look and how you're perceived as through that other person. So one of the questions that I'm asking right now is, like, I'm not really sure, it's fairly new, but how do I see my own sexuality, do I see it through the eyes of myself, or am I seeing it through the validation from another person? It's kind of a weird kind of back and forth. So I created this image, which is based off of the shirts that I've seen some of women wear, where it says, my face is up here. I just wanted to put that out there before I clicked on it. So they wear a shirt, and across their chest it says, my face is up here, with an arrow. So I produced this image, which is the opposite. And it sort of talks about how maybe I need a little bit of validation. Maybe I need to, it's sort of that idea of, I wore my new dress, but he didn't even notice, or that kind of thing. So this is the latest kind of idea that I'm working with, the latest image of myself, and thinking about that idea of validation and where it comes from in a partnership, and sort of being the other in that, and searching for yourself within another person.
Yeah, it has that sort of deer in the headlights look there.
Yeah. Didn't you notice I'm wearing my new dress?
Yeah.
I bought it for you to make you, you know.
But then the letters say my breasts are down here.
Yeah. So it's a play on that idea of, you know, instead of somebody constantly oogling you and you having to remind them that your face is up here, it's reminding them that there's other parts of you that need validation. Or
Yeah, look into my eyes. So where do you think how far do you think something like this can go? What do you want to do with it?
Well, this is just an image, and I have no idea, really, and I that's part of the fun of it. This is a new idea for me, and part of my studio practice is in playing. I like to just play with ideas, and I consider some of the videos that I make sketches, and some of these images, like the one I just showed, is just a sketch of an idea, and there's a lot of humor behind it, just like there is in this sense of play that's really important to my work.
What's on the agenda for you? We have about maybe 5 or 10 minutes here to go.
Well, right now I have a piece of work in a show in Delaware County Community College, which is called Argument with a Baked Cake. I can show you an image of that. And if you want to see that, like I said, it's at the Delaware County Community College, which is on its Marple campus. And this was one of the things that I did soon after I got back from Ireland. And it's one of those argument pieces, a continuation of the argument with the glacial erratic, where I baked this cake. It's a large, elaborate, very beautiful, tasty-looking cake. And then
it's a real cake.
Yes, it's Duncan Hines icing, chocolate drizzles, sprinkles, and cherries. And then I had this argument with it, and it had a lot to do with sort of my ambivalent feelings about what my roles were. I kind of said things to it like, well, you know, I took all this time out of my day to make you, and now you're trying to make me conform to your standards, and I don't understand, because I'm the one who created you, and now you're trying to challenge me, and it could have been worse, I guess. I could have been ironing, and that kind of thing, just playing with this whole idea of what I could have been doing, and then...
So you recorded all of that and put it into those headphones that little girl's listening to?
Right.
Which, you didn't happen to get her reaction from it, did you?
No, I have a lot of different pictures of people listening to the piece, and I always love the images of the little girls that are listening to it, because it's just kind of exciting for me to see that with the context of the piece. And
well, a few years ago there you were.
Yeah.
You know? It would be a good thing to have somebody like you to go and say something like that to you and stir your mind up and get you going, you know? Mm-hmm. I think that's a wonderful thing. Act as a role model.
Yeah. And I just basically really enjoy what I'm doing right now. I really like that people have sort of an open mind, that art isn't just something that you can frame and hang on a wall. It's an experience. It's, you can create a cake and make it into a work of art. And I'm really happy that, you know, it's kind of getting out there that art can be anything, and it's something that I like to think about and that I like to kind of promote.
Well, I see it as kind of a new generation of performance art too, because there's a few performance artists that are doing things in New York mostly, but I just see it as kind of a new wave of a new tradition. I mean, it was something that wasn't there, you know, before the 1960s. I mean, there was no such, well, maybe we can say that the surrealists did something with it, but I think that it's a good thing. Don't let the one form of art die over another one. It seems like they keep saying the painting is dead. Well, it's certainly not very active, but this is a good direction, I think. So you have a book there. What do you got in the book?
Well, this was sort of my notes for the night, and I just kind of wrote down some ideas of what I'm, my new ideas of what I'm working on now. So that's pretty much it, and I have a lot of notes and that kind of thing. Yeah, it's not really a sketchbook. My sketchbook is sort of my video camera and my camera. My studio is like a laptop. It travels with me. So.
Well, that's pretty much how the performance artists of the 60s, they walked around with a suitcase and carried their studio in a suitcase.
So who's your favorite performance artist of the 60s?
My most favorite. Wow. Okay,
The tables have turned.
The tables have turned, yeah. To interview the interviewer. I don't know. I like the conceptual artworks of Lawrence Weiner. You know?
Oh yeah, you had mentioned him before.
Yeah. And how he gave instructions and said, well, this is what I want you to do, and set it up and make it happen and not even touch it. So, you know, it is, there's a lot of performance taking place in different ways too. You know, some artists like let's say Marcus Stavi who actually hires artists to do his work for him. He doesn't paint them at all. His original paintings he's painted like a long time ago, but now he's having other people do his work for him. He gives them the idea, he signs the canvas, and he goes off to Rome.
Sort of like Andy Warhol.
Well, Andy Warhol's one of his big heroes. But yeah, so is there anything that we haven't said that you'd like to mention?
Not that I can think of at this time. Just my project, Choose My Underwear, is still going on. And it's kind of taken a couple different turns that I'm thinking about now, but haven't produced anything that I wanted to show tonight. But, you know, it's still out there. It's on Facebook. It's called Choose My Underwear. It's really easy to look up. So if you want to like that page and participate in it, it's still going on.
So it's under Sarah Francis on Facebook. If you look up Sarah's name on Facebook, you can see her work on Facebook, plus you can also see it in her blog at sarahfrancis01.blogspot.com. You had said something earlier too on your page about finding statues and putting underwear on statues and photographing them.
I did say something like that.
Yeah.
It's something that I was sort of interested in, because specifically the statues that I've sort of encountered as part of this, they promote an idea of the ideal feminine image during a certain time period. And I thought, wouldn't it be interesting if I could then overlay this idea of the ideal feminine image in contemporary society over that idea using underwear? Because, as I was saying before, the underwear is the great sort of multitasking garment. It's, you know, supposed to be hidden, it's supposed to be seen, it's supposed to turn on, it's supposed to, you know, titillate. It does all these things. It's supposed to push things up and push them down and all these kinds of things today.
It's hard to do that with bronze.
Right.
Yeah.
And I just thought it would be interesting to see those two things juxtaposed over each other. A beautiful set of Victoria's Secret bra and panties over a very classical sort of bronze statue or a marble statue. Maybe something a little tacky, maybe some fishnets. It would just take the...
Interesting little juxtaposition.
Yeah.
So. Okay. Well, we've just been given the goodbye signal, which means that the show is over for tonight. And I want to thank you all for joining us. And I want to thank our guest, Sarah Frances Gerschbach, for coming here.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for
it's
coming.
It's been great.
Yeah, I enjoyed it. Everything except our gal pals
now. I hope she's okay.
I hope so, too. But anyway, peace out, folks. Have a wonderful night.
New Arts Alive is produced through Berks Community Television and can be seen live on the second Tuesday of each month at 5 p.m. Consult your local community cable service for live and repeat programming. For more information about the New Arts program and its consultation residencies of artists from the literary, visual, and performing arts, call 683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530. Or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown, PA.
Hours are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, 1 to 5, Saturday, 10 to 2, or by appointment.
This project was supported by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency, through its regional arts funding partnership, Pennsylvania Partners in the Arts, PPA. State government funding for the arts depends upon an annual appropriation by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and support from the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency. PPA is administered in this region by Berks Arts Council. Arts programming on BCTV is also supported by the Wells Fargo Foundation and by Berks Arts Council.